I'm not going to speak for very long. You're going to be here after the whole lesson. It might run into period two, but that's okay, all right? We have a very special guest that's here today. Okay, I'm not going to speak too much. Just going to let you see what happens. I'm going to introduce you to Adisa The Verbalizer.
Thank you, sir. Great introduction. Good morning, everyone. As we said, my name is Adisa. I like to call myself The Verbalizer. Basically, I'm a performance poet. I write poetry and I perform poetry around the country, mainly in schools, in primary and secondary, and I sometimes go abroad as well. But today, I'm in your wonderful school, and I'm really excited to share my work with you and find out how much you like or dislike poetry, because I'm fascinated by the power of spoken word. So, when I perform to young people, I like to bring you into the show. I like to give you a chance to be part of my performance. And how we do that, you ask me questions about my life, like how long have you been writing? Do you write in a special room? Do you have any rituals that you always do? Do you have lots of girlfriends? Things like that. Now, four questions you're not allowed to ask me. You're not allowed to ask me because I find them really annoying. Number one, how tall are you? I'm 6'5", get over it. Number two, how big are your shoes? They're size 12. Number three, do you play basketball? No, I don't. Number four, are you related to Thierry Henry or Will Smith? No, I'm not. So, your questions will be very intelligent on what inspires you, what gets you into poetry, what gets you excited. So, but enough said, let's begin. My first poem requires some crowd participation. You have to join in. You have to shout out a rhyme. It's a rhyming poem. It's very easy. So I might say, this morning I got to the sound of a hen, picked up my paper, picked up my
pen.
Right, to shout out pen, really enthused, really excited, and you'll be fine. Now, if you get every single rhyme right, you're a genius. You don't belong in this school, you belong at NASA. If you're not sure what NASA is, you're dumb. Let's begin. I know you're all very intelligent. I have a funny feeling when I walk to this side, going to be really outstanding. I'm going to get all the rhymes right, and this side's going to flop. All right, here we go. Try your best. It's quite fast, so hold on. Ride with me on this lyrical roller coaster. My syllabus likes to feed your hunger. The pop medal of a Jamaican.
Toaster.
All the words in the English dictionary you come up with toaster. She's actually right, she's right. For those who don't know, when you go to a wedding and you give a toast, you're really giving a speech. So a Jamaican toaster is a man or woman who puts speeches about their history, about their culture over reggae music. They call it toasting. In America, they call it hip.
Hop.
Why didn't they take hop now? It's hop. It's hip hop, that's it. In London, they say, I'm spitting bars, man, when you hear my bars. But the whole idea came from Jamaica in the Caribbean. If you go back in the history, it came from Africa. The idea of griots, storytellers. But anyway, back to the point. Ride with me on this lyrical roller coaster. My cinema slice of feed your hunger. Pop on down like a Jamaican. I've been chilling in my similar cocoon, just biding my time. The moment is perfect, let's get ready to
ride.
Watch your step as my web is spun. From your back to the tick of the light, you travel the more. Submerge yourself in my verbalistic metaphor. Resistance is futile, as I hold the key to the
door.
I leave you tongue-tied like Houdini. You never escape my battle of words. Your belly expands with laughter as you guzzle on my contagious verbs. Mine, acid adjectives hacked deep into your heart. Reprogram your software, be afraid, be so afraid, but this is just the you are reluctant, patient, up as an over-enthusiastic nurse, dripping rhythm and rhyme from a life-saving verse, not curse, not witch. Bringing forth gifts of expression, knowledge of three wise men. Verbal one like me, and the 5 plus 4 makes
10.
Verbalism. Verbalism. A line that cannot contain the fusion of text and colour. My canvas is too big to be framed. There'll be no light limericks. This operation is far too serious for that. Lights, camera, action, cut. That's what I call a rap. It's a rap. It's a rap. Ad-libbing like a master chef preparing food to serve an aging nose. On the whiff of my concoction leaves you all year 7 spellbound by my Moorish. Not my toes. Froze. Froze. It's like a poetic story. You can clap now. Ta-da. Thank you. Has begun, and how it works, literally, he says to me, where do you come from? Where? And I'll tell you where I come from. I actually come from the land of mum. I often get asked, where do you come from? I say, I come from the land of mum. We all come from the land. I believe that we all walk around and say, I am from the land of mum too. High five. There'll be less wars in the world rather than un-Nigerian. I mean, no, we're just from the land of mum. We all come from mum. Every one of us come from mum. Don't worry. So, I'm going to read lots of poems and talk about my life, and why I love poetry, and why I think you'll love it as well. And my poems are poems in books, but I don't call my book a book, I call it a bookie. Let me explain that. Because my poetry in my bookie is so delicious like a cookie, I call it a bookie. Well, that's my clapping, a bookie. Delicious, eat it. What? Feed the soul. You're lost, aren't you? Today is Thursday, 2014. It's just like spaced out, you know? Alright, okay, so you give me the question. You might say, tell us about your first kiss. And I've got a poem about that. Like, I remember my first girlfriend, I can still remember her face. Obviously she had a face. But she had a particularly beautiful face. She had a lovely cheekbone, and I admire cheekbone on a lady. She had a lovely cheekbone. So you ask the question, I'll give you the poem. Who has the first question? Don't be scared of yourself. Good.
Do you have any children?
I have three. My oldest is called Olunchi, he's 9. Middle one is called Chike, he's 6. My baba, just born, he's called Chidi. What do they all have in common? What do they all have in common, young men? Did you hear that? That's funny. What do they all have? They're all yours. You remember before I met at school, right? And I said to him, I've got 2 boys and 1 on the way before the youngest was born. I said, do you know what 1 on the way means? He said, yeah, he's on a plane. They're all yours. No, they've all got chi in their name, C-H-I, chi. And in my wife's Nigerian, and in her culture, chi, in her language, it means God, life force. Which is interesting, because in China, chi force is also God. Isn't that cool? Just like the 2 different cultures, but always in chi as God. It's powerful. All right, next poem. This poem is called Poetry Revolution. It's quite a serious poem. I like his influence poem. It's called Poetry Revolution. Take one line from the poem that speaks to you that you really like, hold on to it, and at the end put your hand up and say, sir, I like that line. We'll talk about it after. It's called Poetry Revolution. So it's a poetry revolution where no one dies. And people stand back and say, oh me, oh my. Where drama lives beyond the stage, where the least important thing standing is the mic. Where politics and love bleed together. Now gather around now and listen to Adisa The Verbalizer. Brrrak, get down, this story's live. And in these times of great confusion, I ask the Lady of Rage for a simple solution. And she says, it's a poetry revolution. I said, with every revolution there must be violence. She said, revolution is a thought planted in the soil of silence. I said, the children are hungry and need to be fed. She said, the bittersweet taste of freedom shall be their bread. I said, we have many soldiers, but who shall lead this war? He said, the one who has wealth but valleys of people more. I said, the enemy is everywhere. Do you really stand a chance? He said, the secret of this fight is hidden inside the dance. I said, when we no longer have to up arms and fight. He said, when the dawn refuses to follow the night. I get it, this battle is eternal, it lasts forever. She said, no, just until our hearts can balance a feather. And in these times of great confusion, I asked the Lady of Rage for a simple solution. And she says, it's verbalism, a revolution. She says, take no prisoners, minefield war. Drop smart bombs for the bright kids on a ghetto floor. Spray them with pepper gas till blue tears sting their red eyes. And when the mist clears with a magnifying glass to see through their lies, hold ignorance hostage. Use knowledge of self to barricade the door. Ring the bell of resurrection, dead can't sleep no more. Let the heavens open, let the libation fall now. Let words become music as we answer the call to the poetry revolution where no one dies. And people stand back and say, oh me, oh my. Where drama lives beyond the stage, where the least important thing standing is the mic. Where politics and love bleed together on the page. You gather around now and listen to Adisa The Verbalizer. Brah, get down, this story is live. Now which line, which phrase or metaphor grabbed your mind and made you say, ah, interesting. Raise your hand now. Yes. Walter, do you like blood?
Yeah.
Good. Now, politics and love bleed together. Sometimes we keep politics and love apart, but I mean they have a role to play together. So in poetry we can talk about politics and we can talk about love as well. Absolutely. Politics and love bleed together on the page. Someone else, a line grabs your imagination, a concept, people, I like that. I really do like that image. Be brave, be brave. Yes.
What about the bread?
Yes. The bittersweet taste of bread be their freedom. Sometimes the truth is bitter, it's not nice. Come on, hear the truth. It needs to be consumed to be free. Sometimes that's where they are. Well done. Good. Okay, next question about my life, about poetry, about growing up. Go for it. And I give you a poem as an answer. Go for it, yeah. Even more handsome. know that's hard to imagine, but I do look even better without the hat. The hat's not coming off, it's not a strip show. Right, next poem. Talking about love, and stripping. Fell in love at a very young age, fell in love at the age of 11. I fell in love with my comedy teacher at school. Don't worry, we did not go to France together, nothing like that. And the idea was that Mrs. Marlowe, my cookery, was a wonderful lady because she would listen to me. As you can probably work out, I talk too much. As a child, I talk too much. I got sent out of class for talking too much, which is really funny because now I get paid to go to schools and talk too much. So if you talk too much, it's probably a good thing, but I talk too much. But Mrs. Marlowe wouldn't judge me, she would listen to me. And one day, her husband came to pick her up from school, and I was so envious of the fact that this man was married to Mrs. Marlowe, I wanted to punch him in his kneecap, because I was this big. And he was a fully grown man, married to Mrs. Marlowe. Anyway, Mrs. Marlowe left the school, I was devastated. This poem is not about Mrs. Marlowe, it's about loving someone. I didn't love her like that, it wasn't like that. Because you can love, like, you know, you can love a book, but you don't kiss the book, do you?
Yeah.
So, love has many forms. So I respected the woman very much. It's part about loving someone, and that person gets removed from your life, and there's a gap. And you can't fill the gap, but you feel that something's missing. And it's called first love. Like snow without white, like a story of no end, like jazz without dizzy, like a spring with no bend, like algae without mass, like a tree with no roots, like a kite without the wind, like an orchard that bears no fruits. Like an alphabet without letters, like a river with no bed, like a rapper without a mic, like a bullfight with no rent, you left me alone. Next question. I like you guys, you're full of questions. Just bubbling over questions. Love it, it's great. Go on, come on. Be brave now. Yes?
What was your inspiration?
Good question. My dad. My mum and dad, really, because my mum had the word. My mum was really like a wordsmith. She was full of stories and proverbs. And my father was full of music. So between the both of them, they kind of rubbed off on me, this love of musicality of words. So, part of my dad. My dad was very strict. He said to me, "You'll never drink coffee in my house until you're a man." So when I was 17, I said, "Dad, I'm 17, can I drink coffee now?" He said, "No, you're not a man." When I was 21, which was last week, I bought it. He said, "Dad, can I drink coffee now?" I said, "Yes, you can drink coffee, you're a man, you've got a beard, go and drink your coffee." So I bought my first jar of coffee. I boiled the kettle, I made him a mug, I gulped it down, and I was physically sick. I hated coffee. After all that waiting, I hated the taste of coffee. Now, my hatred of coffee has extended into coffee shops like Starbucks. I hate Starbucks with their language of Starbucks. Skinny, cappuccino, mocha. This is a poem of Starbucks and it's called Fat Box. I cannot be sued, I don't mention the word Starbucks, I just say Fat Box. Fat Box, if you get the joke. Some of you will get it, some of you just go, don't get it. But some of you will get it. I know you will, because you're smart like that. Fat Bucks. A man with skinny legs walked into a skinny shop, ordered a skinny cappuccino and a skinny chocolate chip muffin to go. The skinny waitress said, "That'll be a fiver." He pulled his skinny wallet from his pocket, paid the waitress with a skinny smile. She took the money and placed it in the fat till. Thank you. Told you. I didn't get it. Tomorrow morning, you're going to wake up and say, "I get it! Ha 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 ha!" And go back to sleep. And next question. I do like questions. You guys are bullets there. Yes? Oh, I've got quite a few. The lady in this country is a poet laureate. Her name's Carolyn Duffy. I like her work a lot. It's a man called John Agar from Diane in the Caribbean. I like him a lot as well. So, yeah, it's quite a few. But those two are kind of. I have. They're poets, no, they're just my brothers. They're just brothers. They're not real poets like me, they're just brothers. I started quite late, I started at about 25. But it's because of school. She said, "I thought you were 21. It was a joke. I was 21 a long time ago. At school, they taught me nursery rhymes. Like Jack and Jill went up. I didn't care about Jack, I didn't care about Jill. So I made my own version of Jack and Jill just to annoy my teacher. So this is my version of Jack and Jill. I know you're in year 7, you don't laugh at nursery rhymes because you're too mature. But I reckon my poem about Jack and Jill is so funny that when you get up at the end of this performance, there's going to be a puddle on the floor. So don't embarrass yourself and don't laugh. In fact, try your best not to laugh. I'll make you laugh when you break the chair. Here we go. I give you all 10 pounds, please? No. Here we go. Charlotte and I. Jack and Jill bungee jumped off the hill, but I wanted some time alone. The rope snapped, Jill broke her back, and Jack laughed all the way home. Thank you. Some did not laugh. I'll get you now with my Jack Sprat. This is my remix of Jack Sprat. You're going to love it. Jack Sprat, the original goes to one girl. The original one goes, Jack Sprat can eat no fat, his wife can eat no lean. So between them both, they lick the platter clean. That's an old English nursery rhyme. It's really boring. Here's the remix. Jack Sprat can eat no curry, his wife can eat no rice. So between them both, they eat Chinese. So my mother was full of Caribbean proverbs, like, you can be on holiday in the Caribbean, standing behind a donkey. It's not a clever idea to stand behind donkeys, because donkeys will kick you in the wrong place and it will hurt. And my mother, she wouldn't say to me, son, move away from the donkey before you get hurt. She wouldn't do that. She'd tell me a Caribbean proverb about life that had such depth to it that as a child I didn't understand. So I'm standing behind a donkey, she'd say, if you play with puppy one day, dog, lick your moat. Exactly. I stood there going, what? And the donkey kicked me and it hurt. I did not understand what she was talking about as a child. As I grew, I started to understand the wisdom in her proverbs. I've got one for you now. If you can explain what this means in real life, I'll give you a bookie. I'll give you a brand new spanking bookie. Here, work one out. When turkey foot broke, it can come there with fowl. All right, I'll do it in a way you might understand. When a turkey's foot is broken, only then will it keep company with a fowl. Okay, one more try. Slow. Only when the turkey's foot is broken will it ever think about becoming friendly with the fowl. What is the myth? The fowl is the chicken. I don't know. Right now. Only when you stop being selfish will you be able to diss other people. She started off so well. What do you mean, diss other people? Positive becomes a negative. With an oxymoron thing. Well said. If you stop being selfish, more people will start to like you. I like that. I thought you said that, but it's wrong. But let's try it, Mike. When it happens, you realize you're hurt. Good try. Hey. Are you saying, so you're friends with somebody, and then when the relationship breaks down, what happens? Good point. You're close. One more shot, young lady. You look very intelligent. You've got glasses on. And glasses always means intelligence. Speak. I'll explain. The turkey, which is physically bigger than the fowl, the chicken, walks around all day long like, we're turkeys, we're magnificent. Like you. You walk around your school like, la la la, we're turkeys, we're so fine, la 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 la. Now, imagine a new boy or girl came to your school, wants to become friends with you. You're like, hold on a minute, do you know who we are? We're the turkey crew. What do you say? We're the turkeys. And you push them away like, you can't join us, we're the turkey crew, we're magnificent. But when you're in trouble, as you rightly said, when things go wrong in your world, you turn to the one before who wasn't good enough or bad enough and say, you can become my friend now. So my mother was trying to teach me, don't put yourself on a pedestal like you're superior to anyone. Treat others as you'd like to be treated. This poem is about my mother. It's called Mama Always Told Me. Because she did. Mama always told me, son, walk the streets with your head held high. You have no limitation. If you want to, you can fly. Success does not come to those who sit down and wait. If you don't knock, no one will open the gate. Mama told me, put God first in everything you do. Believe in yourself, your dreams must come true. Someone tried to hold you down, never regret your skin is brown. She told me the role of life is rough and oh so long. When your father's gone, just pick yourself up and just carry on. Respect your parents and your elders, your days are long. When you have children of your own, sing to them this song. And she said, put a little by for a rainy day. Remember my son, what you sow shall be your pay. The time to work and the time to play. Bend the tree while it's young, so when it's older it won't go astray. She said, you never miss the water till the well runs dry. It's because a man does not mean you cannot cry. In the classroom of life, do not be afraid to ask the question why. There's no such thing as failure. I'm going to put in mind if you try. Say the child does not heed the words of their mother. You have to drink lime, pepper juice and salt. You will not be judged by your words, but the content of your heart. Thank you. Clap now. Question.
Why do you wear that hat?
Why do you wear that hair?
I need it on
as well. In my hat, but you need your hair. Good. She doesn't write poetry, but she's not lying anymore, but she doesn't write poetry, but she has great stories, a great storyteller. Yeah.
Did you say
rap poet
over
there? Rap poet. I'm not a rapper. But for you, my friend,
yeah.
I will rap for you. There you go. Here we go. Thank you. Let's have a competition. I like competitions. And all you have to do is tell me at the end of the poem, what is the poem about? It's about one thing or one thing only. Get it right, I'll give you a book. Get it right. Quite easy. But it's not what it appears to be. It's a bit tricky. You've got to put your mind to it. Let's have a competition. Here we go. You get this right, you're super intelligent. You really are. Here we go. She's kind enough to house the baby. She's the washing line that holds the stars. The gold that runs through nature's veins. She's the power in a diplomat's car. She's a belt of respect that ties a martial arts suit. She's the center of the earth, home for the barbar tree roots. She's a financial caviar for a wealthy diet. She's a tide inside my head when the curtain falls and all is quiet. She's a solid eclipse many wait a lifetime to see. She's a runaway stallion with no footprints and no quest to be free. She's a coffee in my cup, no need for white clothes. Like an uncut diamond, she dresses in carbon rose. She's a view inside the cocoon before the butterfly takes flight. She's a backdrop to life's movies and credits scroll into the night. She's a natty dread hairstyle, uniting the people like rope. She's an old man river spiritual, her voice brings 10 tons of hope. She's limitless like the desert, more attractive than quicksand in space. Behind her back, many mock her, too afraid to say it to her face. She's the absorber of light. She is. Go. You're married? You have a wife? Okay, no, it's not my wife. Good answer, Mother Nature. It's not Mother Nature. They're coming for you very soon. Just sit quietly and I'll take care of you. Okay? Good. Question. Not about, come on, my mother. Not about a human being. Not about a human being.
She's a badger.
Who?
A badger.
A badger. An animal, a badger.
Yeah.
No. Angel. Good answer, not angel. Universe, good answer. She's kind enough to house the baby. This thing surrounds the baby in her mother's womb. The baby cannot escape this world until it enters the world. What is the baby surrounded by? It's not a belly. It's deeper than that. You take the seed, you open the earth. You put the seed inside the earth, you cover it over. The seed is covered by this thing. It grows inside this world until it sprouts out. A knock. A dog. God, good answer. God, very good answer. That's a very profound answer. God surrounds me. It's a good answer. Not God, good answer. Look, give me a clue. You do martial arts. You reach a high level, they give you this thing, a sign of respect. What do they give you? What's the word? Put your hand up, say the word. It's not belt. Not the award. It's a special type of... Think about it. The stars hang on this thing at night time. The stars hang on this thing. They hang on it. They relax on it. You see the stars because of this thing. Not light. No, night time. Night sky. Night sky is... Darkest quote. Martial arts, they give you... Yeah, she said it eventually. Black, the word black. The poem was looking at the word black, how we look at the word black. So the baby surrounding the womb is dark, it's blackness. You put the seed into the black earth. Financial caviar, you've got money in the bank, you're in the black. In debt, you're in the red.
it looks at the word black. Why? In the dictionary, the English dictionary, when we look at the word black and words that connect to it, double barrel words, blackmail, black magic, black market, we often see black as a negative, as a bad thing. I was looking at black as a positive thing, the positive side of black as opposed to the bad, seeing the goodness in it, because I call myself black. I was looking for the positive. Good. Question. Let's go deeper. Come on, yes.
What's your favorite animal?
I like elephants. You go nice with French fries. I write in my office. I have an office at the top of my house. I've got a loft conversion. I write in that room. I always write in the same room. Do I play? Flabberbird. Is that a game?
Yes.
I don't know the game. I'm not good at games. Thanks for asking. Good. My children ever? Not really. I don't leave them around for them to do that. But good point. They don't really. They just tell me they like it or don't like it. I ask them. What's my deepest secret? I don't know. It's kind of scary. My deepest secret. Don't tell me I'll kill you. I don't know, I think about that one. Okay, have you heard the saying, the pen is mightier than the sword?
Yes.
The pen is mightier than the sword. Who's heard the saying before? Put your hand up. What does it mean? I tell you.
It means that you can do more with the pen.
Yes, you can do more with the pen. But let's imagine you have a big biro and I have a samurai sword. And we go to war. Surely you die first. Who lives longer, the warrior or the writer?
The
writer. What you write, what you write can stay around for centuries, hundreds of years. It's good. How old is Shakespeare? Yeah, it's a long time. People are still reading it. He's dead a long time, still reading it. So it can live on. Yes, sir, women. I'm going to come to that. I'm going to do this poem first, right? This poem is about, one second, everyone, nice and back. Thank you. This poem is about the power of writing, and it's called My Instrument, My Pen. And it's dedicated to a man called Alade Equiano. You can raise your hand and tell me who Alade Equiano was, I'll give you a prize. Who was Alade Equiano? Go.
A poem writer?
It wasn't a poem writer. Good try. Who was Alade Equiano?
Pirate.
He wasn't a pirate. Those pirates were in his world. Pirates were in his world. He interacted with pirates. He was not a pirate. He was opposite of a pirate.
He
was a good person, but he wasn't a fighter like that. Good. No, but he had that name because of the people who captured him. Alade Equiano, good. Right, now, you're on the right track. I prefer to call him an enslaved African. I think language is really important. If we say he was a slave, that means that's all you are. You are a slave, you were born a slave. No, he was someone who was captured and forced into slavery. So I prefer the language of he was an enslaved African. That person was enslaved. He was made to be a slave, because he was a slave. So Alade Equiano was born in Nigeria at the age of 11. He was kidnapped, forced into the transatlantic slave trade. He was taken to the Caribbean island of Barbados. He worked on the sugar plantation, terrible conditions. He then was taken to England. And in England, he managed to buy his freedom. You could buy your way out of freedom, depending on the person who owned you. He bought his way out of freedom. He paid £40 to become a free man. Is that crazy? He paid £40 to become a free man. When he became a free man, he wrote a book about his life, about his culture in Nigeria, what happened in Barbados, and what happened in London, England. And he took this book, called The Interesting Narratives of Alade Equiano. He went to the Houses of Parliament and said, listen, slavery is barbaric. It needs to be abolished. And he campaigned in his book, relentlessly, to get slavery abolished. So he was a freedom fighter with words. And this poem is for him, it's called My Instrument, My Pen. My instrument, my pen, a steel quill tied to a hunter's spear. Black blood squirts through bamboo veins, leaving tattoos on a pirate of a soul. My instrument, my pen, ebony drumsticks beating Afrobeat blues of redemption song on racism's tight goatskin head. My instrument, my pen, scribing my art laws, but they ain't new. They surfaced before like African moors, guided by Yemanja, arriving on European shores. My instrument, my pen, daubing mules of inspiration, of red, black, and green landscapes, refocusing your image of my nation. My instrument, my pen, engraving future footprints on our children's beach, dousing flames of fear, ignorance, and deceit.
I'm dunking metaphors of love into plain paper baskets like wings were attached to my feet. My instrument, my pen, wrapping griot tales around full moon fires, rekindling the ancestors, unifying our voices in celebration choirs, unifying our voices in celebration choirs. Next question.
What's your favourite colour?
Your colour brown. I drive an old Mercedes, and old Mercedes are stained. I'm not into cars, I'm into bikes. I like fast bikes. Bicycles, not motorbikes. Many countries. I've been to America, to a place called Atlantic America. I've been to Switzerland, I've been to Brussels, France, in Africa, I've been to South Africa, Ghana, where else? Mozambique, Kenya, Egypt, yeah, many places. For my children, yeah, there's one, but I'll read that later. Something else spoken? I really like cookery for chart. I'm not into cookery. Good chart. But I came to poetry quite late, about age 25. So I came to poetry quite late. Yeah, good. I think I like observing people, human nature. I think human beings are fascinating. The good things we can do and the bad things we can do, I find that interesting. Just how we can do such wonderful things of generosity and charity in the world, and the humanists can turn around and do such evil like war. And I find that fascinating, how we can be so different from that. Observing people, humankind, us.
How fast can you sing a rap?
I can't. I can't rap.
What's your favorite place in the world?
That's a good question. I guess inside my own head. Inside my head. Right, here we go. Poetry. Now. I'm going to pick on someone. Let me pick on you. What's your name? Floyd, great name, Floyd. Floyd, when you were a little boy and you were walking through the park with your mum for the first time, you said, Floyd, that's a tree, for the very first time. And you said, okay, mummy. In a really deep bass voice she'd never heard before. And you said, Floyd, look up, that's the sky. And Floyd said, okay, mummy. When I was a little boy, Floyd, mum said to me, Adisa, that is a tree. I said, why is it called a tree then, mummy? And she got very upset and slapped me in the back of my head. Do not worry, my mum did not abuse me, it was my dad. Now, so Floyd, I was not abused. Floyd, the answer is this, the question is this. Did you ask questions as a child, or was you an okay mummy kind of child? Did you say why, or did you go okay mummy? You don't know. Are you a why person now, or okay mummy now? You still call mummy mummy, don't you? You still call mummy mummy, don't you? You call her mummy, don't you? What do you call your mum? You call her mum. Do you ask questions, or you don't ask questions? Good. I have a question for you. I believe that to live your life and not ask questions is to waste your life. You must question things around you. You must question things all the time. I believe that. Now, I have a question for you. Get it right, I'll give you a book. I'll give away the book. I will. Here we go. Why do we call oranges oranges and we don't call bananas yellows? It's a deep question. Go for it, young man.
Is it because
of
the name of a fruit?
I know it's the name of a fruit. You lied to me. Funny. He says, lemons are yellow too. Now I'm talking about oranges. That is ill. That's really funny. Yeah. Good point. The inside of the orange is actually orange. Orange on the outside and on the inside, so we call it an orange. But the banana, it's got white on the inside, so why don't we call it a yellow, a white yellow? Go on then, Mr. Rapper. Well said, well said. One more try. Okay, good point. Okay, I don't know the answer to the question, I don't care. But what's important is questioning life around you. This poem is called Wonderful World. I'd like to shout out the missing rhyme. I'd like to spell that. Shout out the missing rhyme, see if you get it right. It's called Wonderful World. Ever wondered where the rainbows go when the sun, rain and sun are called the truths? Ever wondered why the elders say things are so much better in life? elders don't have juice. They think about their youth. Juice, fast and juice trap. Here we go. Ever wonder why parents talk in riddles, so I make myself clear? Ever wonder how simple onion with a grown man should have?
Yeah.
Tear not beer. Not shed beer. Ever wonder why wars are started and detention to bring peace? Ever wonder why computers eat kilobytes yet have no?
Yeah.
Good. Ever wonder why common sense is called common when it's not? Ever wonder why a sentence is naked without a fall?
Oh.
Ever wonder why the giant father always pine never shows its face? Ever wonder what the world would be like if we all believed in the human?
Race.
Ever wonder why we value gold and respect our mother earth? Ever wonder why love is so scarce for every child in a sack full at?
Birth.
Ever wonder why pianos have keys but can't open any locks? Ever wonder why books have spines and three hands are pinned to a? Ever wonder why children want to be old and adults want to be young? Ever wonder how words are written to take a bad situation and turn it into fun? Ever wonder do poets have to answer many questions they ask? Ever thought, am I who I am, or is wearing a? If you answered yes to any of the above, then maybe, just maybe, you are a poet too. Next question.
Who would
you meet a celebrity?
Who would
you meet? If I was going to meet a celebrity, who would I meet? I've met quite a few over my time. VIPs of the like of Joanna Lumley. Prince Charles? I met Prince Charles at a farm and I gave him a potato. Who believes I met the next king of this country? I took a potato out of my pocket, gave it to him, and he took the potato. Who believes it actually happened? It did. It did. Yeah. I'll tell you later, but it did. Speak. Favorite school I've been to? This school. If I was stuck in a lift with a celebrity, who would I want the celebrity to be? I have to say, I'm not really into celebrity watching. I don't really care about people and their lives outside of my family's life. But if I was stuck in a lift with a celebrity, it'd be a lady called Mayor Angela. Well, you can find out. Find out. Mayor Angela. Here we go. Weirdest line in the poem, tell a story. What's the weirdest line ever written in a poem? Well, it's about story. I had pins and needles one night. You know pins and needles, that sensation? I had this pins and needles in my left arm. I was sleeping in my bed. So I was half awake, half asleep. But I decided to slap my arm to check if it was me. So I'm slapping my own arm thinking, that's not my arm. There's someone in my bed trying to kill me. And I get really scared and I fall off my own bed, shouting out, who are you, let go. I then get off the floor, true story, I run to the light switch to find out who's in the bed. When I get to the light switch, I run this stupid idiot's own left arm. Now, the moral to my story, because all my poems have some deep morals in them, the moral to this story is, in life, never be afraid of your own left arm. Thank you. Next question to a poem. Wow, big question. Why do you think poetry could end racism? I don't believe poetry has the power to do that, but I believe poetry can help people to understand racism, understand each other more, better. So it's all about understanding and respecting other cultures, and I think it can do that. Yeah. Yes?
Lee, what's your funniest joke you've ever said?
Funniest joke ever?
Yeah.
Right, here we go. So this is a true story. It's a joke, it's a true story. A boy in the school said to me, can I have one of your books? I said, I give away 2 free books on every visit. He said, no, I haven't got any money, I can't afford your book, but I like your poetry. Can I have the book? I said, if I give you this book now, my children will not eat tonight. The boy looked me straight in the eye and said, what? You feed your children books? So I dance like a butterfly. Ah, I'm not dancing you. Here we go, next poem. Time's running. Now, let's have a serious poem. Quite a serious poem. I mentioned before that my father was very strict. My father was a very loving man. He's no longer alive now, rest his soul. But my dad was very kind of, I'm the father, and I provide for you, but I don't do that kind of old hands running down the park as a little boy, jumping around, playing football. I don't do that stuff. Mum can do that. I don't do that. I just provide for the family. So he kept it kind of distance from me. Even though he loved me, he wouldn't show it in a I wanted my dad, who's a big man, to pick me up and throw me like a rag doll, but not let go. Just swing me around like that and land me on his shoulders and say, this is my boy. My dad didn't show his love in that physical way. He told me I love you. Anything I needed was there. But he didn't do that hands-on, throw me up in the air. Didn't do that kind of stuff, my dad. That's the way he was raised as well. So he's kind of a bit cold like that. So my father passed away in 1999. Saying goodbye to my father at the funeral, I decided to touch my father's head for the last time. I'm standing there, my mother and my two brothers. As I touch his head, I'm shocked. I'm not shocked by the fact my father died. I accept that's part of life. What shocked me was how soft my father's hair was. Which sounds kind of bizarre, I explain that. I realized in that church at that moment, I'd never felt my father's face or his hair before. But as a child, I'd never embraced him and said, wow, your hair. Never touched it. Like some children, they go home, they can jump on their dad and bear hug them and just, I couldn't do that. I couldn't think to do that. So I go into schools now, I say to young people, if you wanted to, I don't know who you live with, could you touch your father or your mother's hair? Could you just go, could you do that if you wanted to? Would you go out? Most people say yes, some say no. So I couldn't do it. I couldn't even think to do it. So, wrote a poem about my dad. It's not about touching his face, it's about making bread. My father was a master baker. And when he made this special bread, he shut down the kitchen. My mother had to leave the kitchen. My brothers had to leave the kitchen. I was the only one allowed in the family to watch my father make this special bread. And when he made this bread, I felt very close to my dad. And this poem about watching him make bread is called Sweet Bread Communion. And for those of you who don't know what sweet bread is, it's bread that's very sweet. Sweet Bread Communion. Friday night was sweet bread night. I'd hear whistling from the kitchen, a sign that was about to break bread. It was always the same tune. Oh, island in the sun. He rolled back his sleeves as if folding the St. Vincent flag. He preferred fresh yeast, huge hands breaking wet clay. Balanced on a wooden stool and watched his problems dissolve. The marriage of yeast and sugar turned the kitchen into a brewery. When he was sure no one was looking, he'd add the secret ingredient. Fresh grated coconut then stirred until the sweet spirit disappeared. Next, the flour made its entrance on the lofty height of the sieve. Dad's arms resembled a concrete mixer with mechanical gyrating, his tennis ball biceps expanding and contracting. The mixture slides like a sledge on a snow white flower. Into the deep tints to sleep, a damp tea towel for a blanket. As they snore, they rise, their pot bellies facing the sun. Dad opens the furnace to be greeted by golden faces with raisins for eyes. Pressing two fingers into their foreheads, they bounce back like mini trampolines. A sponge dipped in nutmeg and honey water christens the newborn bread. Last couple of questions and I must say goodbye. Last couple of questions and I'll do one more poem. I'll say goodbye. For £1? You can buy a book for £1 plus £4.99. Speak. That too. No, to my brothers. That too. Quite a few years, about 10 years. Yeah. I'm not that sporty, I like coming through, I like coming through. A bit louder? That's a good question. I think I did, I had to, it was so funny what you said. I did give it a book, I did. I had to, it was so funny. Oh dear, he said the word, he said football. I hate football. I tell you what, I can appreciate the skill in 11 individuals kicking a little bit of leather into a gigantic net. Little ball, big net. Ball goes in the net. Yay! Jump on your friend's back, go, ah. I can see the skill. But I don't understand. I cannot comprehend how we can pay in 2014, pay someone £200,000 a week to kick a little bit of ball. Leather into a big net and go, ah. I don't understand. A little while ago, I've got a poem for you, It's on my pink machine. Do not laugh at my pink case and in touch with my feminine side. A little while ago, where is it? A little while ago, the icon of football, this is David Beckham. This is not an attack on Beckham, I like the guy who was making jewelry. But the point is this, a little while ago, Mr. Beckham broke a bone in his foot. One of the best poets in the country, the Sun, took a picture of the man's hairy foot and put it on the front page. I'll slow it down. They photographed Mr. Beckham's hairy foot and put it on the front page of the newspaper. There are children dying in this world. There are wars going on. And you put a man's hairy foot on the front page of a newspaper. I got very upset and I wrote this poem. This is for you, my friend, who likes football. When I say to you, have you seen the news today, you're all going to go, no, like a Mexican wave. That's your big idea. No. You do the big idea, no, that's really good. Whenever I say the news, but you go, no. Okay, here we go. Newsflash. Have you seen the news today?
No.
200 die in freak flooding. 12-year-old still not found. 1 billion stolen dime or dollar falls against the pound. Suicide bomber kills 15. And David Beckham might not be fit to play with the England team. Did you hear the news today?
No.
Crack cocaine floods British streets. Gang warfare reaches all-time high. Lion escapes from city zoo. Petrol prices rocket the sky. Man drinks anthrax for sake of a cream. News just coming in. Mr. Beckham is still not fit for the England team. Did you catch the news today?
No.
1 in 3 homeless women try prostitution. Bush prepares for war. Inner city black kids at risk of exclusion. Cancer linked to mobile phone radiation. Health minister says no evidence has been seen. And after press, Mr. Beckham is still not fit for the England team. Did you hear the news today?
No.
Icelandic ice caps melting due to global warming. Rap sensation Eminem's lyrics blamed for drive-by shooting. Star Wars fanatic kills his playmate imitating heroes on cinema screen. And after press, Mr. Beckham is still not fit for the England team. Did you hear the news today? Yes. I did. What's the latest? Mr. Beckham is now fit and ready for the England team. Thank you. I stress, I actually like David Beckham. He's a very solid, grounded individual. It wasn't about Beckham, it was about how much focus we put on the sport of football. He's a nice guy. You can have a moment, folks. Good. I can too. One person said black, he said black. Is it back? Is it you? You want a book? Be happy. Cause I'm so happy every day. Cause I'm so... Sorry. It's a great song.
If you wear a bow tie, you
have to wear a fez. No, no, you don't have to. You can do it. Down to start. Yeah. Favorite? Poem. I'll do it now. I'll end on my favorite poem. Couple more questions.
Do you think
you're I do. He said, do you think I do? I think my children have over 100 books to read. And lots of books. And the whole library in their room. Because I think books can really transform your mind. So books are really important. They don't eat them, but they read lots of books. We'll see. We'll do a deal. We'll do it over there. Movies and books. I prefer, I like them both. Good movies are good. I like them both. I like books about movies. Yeah. I like unicorns. I haven't met you lately, but I do like the idea of unicorns. One more. I have, many years ago, and I won it. Yay! Here we go. Last poem, you guys have been amazing. Amazing, you have been amazing. It's called Words. When I say to you W-O-R-D-S, you're all going to go words like a Mexican wave. You're going to go words. I like words. W-O-R-D-S.
Words.
That sounds like worms. It's got to be like words. I'm really excited. So, here we go.
W-O-R-D-S. Words.
Are food that cannot be eaten, but still they feed my mind. Wallowing the words of wisdom, surprised at what you'll find. Words together make a sentence. A sentence makes a paragraph. Some have made me angry, some have made me laugh. Words are used to hypnotize, but some folks in a trance. Words that turn rhythm and music and make you want to. Words that share between two people misunderstood can make them fight. Words like a key in a lock and expose you to the light. Words that really inspire, like when Bob Marley took the mic, he said, get up, stand up, stand up for you. Yeah. Right. Some people say, I want to be rich without money, life's a bore. But let me say, the more you know of life, the more you feel secure. Words can help you understand the future and what's gone on before. See the book as a stairway leading you to a door. And once inside, don't stop searching until you find the core. If you get lost, I'll find your message washed up on the... Inside of you is a story just waiting to take flight. But I'm really trying to say, every one of us can write. Write of wars, of hatred, of peace that's yet to come. Write of people understanding the tongue must replace the gun. Write of nature, to which we all belong. Write for living for today, but tomorrow you could be gone. If you leave your words in a book, your legacy will carry on. Maybe your words will inspire the next generation to learn from you and go deeper and then beyond. So get a pen, some paper, sit right down, make a start. You don't need to worry about the format as long as it comes from the heart. Yes, Seven, you've been amazing. Great questions. And I hope you enjoyed the poetry. Thanks for coming.